I think ours is better.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
I'm Kyle.
And this is the Concept Crucible Podcast.
We're back for some more D&D action.
Yes. It isn't a real season of the podcast unless we talk about D&D, and we're going to talk about D&D a bunch this season. Specifically, today, being a new D&D player. Mm-hmm. Because, Kyle, you just started playing D&D.
Yes, I did.
And so that'll be our icebreaker. Is get you to open with that. Is how long have you been playing D&D, and what sort of conditions brought you in?
I have been playing D&D for 2 months, and the conditions were listening to a D&D campaign every Wednesday. it's intriguing and becomes super awesome to listen to, and so you want to be part of it, really.
I'm flattered. That is, of course, mine, because Kyle's my roommate. Huck, how about you?
So in the pre-show, I realized that I've been playing for almost 15 years, which didn't feel like it was that long. But so I started grade 11 or so in high school, so 16, 17, I think it was. I was hanging out with my buddy Matt, and he said that the guy who got him into D&D, it really does sound like a drug thing. Like, got him into
D&D,
they invited me out. And so, I was just playing in Doug's basement with his cat Toad running around. And yeah, just lots of pizza and pop and a lot of 2-hour games stretched over like 8 or 9 hours because we metagamed the shit out of it. Mm. Yeah, it was good times.
Now you have pizza, pop, and podcasting.
Yep. Some things never change.
Well, they're more alliterative.
Yeah.
I have been playing D&D specifically for about 18 years, which I guess is not shocking given that I'm the old man of the podcast. Mm. And that I do all the D&D stuff. And I got into it because I'd been running my own games using systems that I invented that I like barely understood. I had been running Warhammer Fantasy, and I'd met a new group of friends in high school, and they were into D&D and Vampire the Masquerade. I was LARPing, and they were like, dude, do you want to play D&D? And I was like, dude, it's my fondest wish. Like, I'd read D&D books, but I'd never had a firm enough grip on the mechanics as a kid. And I'd never, like, had anybody who played. So I couldn't really like it's the kind of thing that it's really hard to learn on your own, like in a vacuum. So I learned, and I started running second edition D&D and then playing in third edition D&D. And it was it was a good time. And here we are now, 3 editions later, and I am running 2 games and like websites and stuff like that. So, being a new... But we were all new players once. Mm-hmm. So, what is it like being new? Kyle, we're going to make you go first because you're newest.
Yep.
And you sort of hold the floor.
Being new. It's intimidating in a sense because there are, like in my campaign, there are some seasoned players who you know, of course, they know what they're doing. They know all of the most of the mechanics or all of the mechanics. Jim will say, do a constitution check, and I might not know what that means, and so I have to like ask him, what do I have to do, what stats do I need to look at, what die do I need to roll, and then there's of course the role playing aspect where I don't want to be boring and I don't want to be annoying, so it's intimidating in that regard. But it's also a lot of fun because, of course, you get to roleplay in a character. This is the first time that I'm playing a character that is... I'm going to probably lean towards a sort of more dark or evil side. Normally, I play a character who's super, generous, super kind, on the light side.
Link to Kyle's character blog in the show notes, assuming he puts something there.
Yeah, I should. I really should. No pressure. Yeah, but with like RPGs, JRPGs, and video games, like I'm always gonna, you know, pick the nice comment. Like if you have an option during the plot of a game to like say something crappy or say something nice, I'm not gonna do the crappy thing because I feel bad. So there's like a little bit of cognitive dissonance in that regard where now I'm trying to play the evil character, and it's difficult.
It's interesting too. Like you pick that challenge as your first character concept.
Yeah.
But yeah, and our group's a little different because we were with 7 players, so it can be hard to get a voice in edgewise. It's important to make sure that we all listen to each other. Huck, what was it like for you being new back in the wilds of 3rd edition?
I'm thinking about it in reference to what it's like now. It was a lot more immersive when I first got into it, and I don't know if that's a function of me being more jaded, me being more rules procedural now, or if I was more imaginative at the time. I'm not entirely sure, but I remember more viscerally living in the moment of the creation, so much so that when I described it to other people, whenever you describe a really good game to somebody else, it's like you're describing a video game. It's so complex, and it's so weird. Like, I mean, for us, we didn't really use boards at all. Like at one point, we had used boards only for battles, but for the most part, we didn't need maps. Some DMs that I've played with use maps as a kind of interesting storytelling tool, where they only reveal stuff on the map as you explore it. And then they'll like roll things like weather and encounters that way. So it felt more immersive at the time. But I can completely relate with just the rules side of it, of feeling so overwhelmed by it because you have an idea. I came from playing video games first and then D&D. In video games, the rules are already set up and it's already meant to be kind of intuitive, so you know you're able to do things, where in D&D it takes a lot more work to figure out whether or not you can do something like that. I think that's the best summary of what it was like.
I'm gonna let you finish, but let me tell you kids about 2nd edition.
Yeah. Lay it on us. The AD&D.
The advanced Dungeons and Dragons. Let me tell you, your armor class went down, and there weren't any skills.
This is back when elves were a class.
No. 2nd edition elves were a race.
Oh, were they?
But if you wanted to multi-class, your life would be a living nightmare forever. You had non-weapon proficiencies, and we didn't have things like points. You know, can you jump across that pit? Who knows? Your strength could be 18 with a decimal.
Really?
Yeah, 18. Your best strength was, if you rolled an 18 strength, you got to roll percentile dice next to that. And so if you had like an 18 over 50 strength, that was better than a regular 18, but it wasn't as good as an 18 over 100.
Mm-hmm.
Which was amazing. And then if you had a 19 strength, that whole percentile thing just went out the window. If you had enough constitution, you'd just regenerate your hit points.
Mm.
all kinds of... It was, 2nd edition is bullshit, and I don't recommend it. You didn't just roll to hit. You had to roll and then check your THACO against the target's AC based on a chart. It's a long story. It was awful. And essentially, you wind up either obeying the rules and like spending a lot of time and effort obeying the rules, or just being like, oh, fuck it. We did a little of both. But no, I remember being new. I think I only played in a couple of games. Like a couple of sessions. And then I started GMing. And like GMing, it was for me was really just a matter of like taking what I'd been doing in other systems, which is just imagining characters and imagining situations and imagining my players in them, and applying that to a new rule set. So it's here's cool monsters with cool art. Here's, you know, distinct and different situations in an interesting world. And here's what it means for a world to be interesting. Like, that was one of my first forays into, like, world building. And then I got out of D&D and into running horror for, like, a decade.
Hmm.
And I ran D&D once in a while, like, from 2003 onward. And I ran a lot of horror. But the first game where I played, I remember, you know, spending a ton of time on my character, and, you know, I was level one, I was a wizard, and so you take, like, magic missile and sleep and light, and you just hope for the best, because you only got, like, 3 hit points. And I died. Did I die? I don't remember. I think the game ended rather than me dying, but I only had 3 hit points, so it was inevitable. God, back in the day. I don't recall it being super challenging, but I'd already been doing role-playing type, like tabletop role-playing type stuff since I was like 10. So the specifics of the rules were challenging, especially because they were awful and Byzantine. But, like, the notion that I think that sort of new player question, and Kyle, I think maybe you'll back me up on this, that there's a distinction between knowing, do I roll dice for this, or what dice do I roll for this?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And those are that's a meaningful distinction, because sometimes, like getting from one to the other is tricky. And happily, games have done a bunch to make that more accessible. And story-wise, God. Second edition, you did what the GM wanted you to do. You didn't, at least with the people I played with. Like it wasn't like a, how do I express my character and their goals? It was, listen, what's the thing that's happening? What evil scourge is plaguing the world?
I remember you find yourself in a bar. What do you do?
Yeah, I had a bunch of those. You know, you find yourself in a bar. What do you do? I remember catching hell because I didn't give people a clear direction. I was just like, no, just here's this world. Make choices, and then those choices will have consequences. And it was like it was really weird. They're like, no, you need to, like, what's the plot? I'm like, no, there is no plot. Now I do both. Like, here's this world, make choices. Also, there's a plot. like also, there are things happening outside of you, and some of those things affect you. So what are some of the challenges of being a new player? I mean, you mentioned role-playing. You mentioned, like, concerns about being boring.
Yeah, certainly, because you want to... make sure that you're not irritating the other players, and especially because, I mean, these characters are, the characters that people are playing are characters that they've been building and, you know, spending time with, so you don't want to accidentally kill your friend's character, because that is, that could be very bad.
Yeah.
And as I said before, with, like, when I'm... like, my character right now is not magical, and I did that, again, deliberately, because normally I would play, you know, the really good magical wizard, the really good mage, the really good wizard, and I sort of thought to try something a little bit different, but it's difficult, because I'm sort of going against what I would normally do in a game, or and stuff like that, and even sort of trying to roleplay that kind of thing, like... I still, if I do something, you know, crappy as my character in D&D, I feel guilty, and then, like, it's
so great. It's so great. You have no idea, so, man. Trust me. We'll get there. Give it like 4 more months.
I guess it's my turn for a challenge.
Yeah, yeah.
I think I have the same challenge now that I did when I first started. And this ties into a joke that you made that people who don't think they're good with acting and don't think they're good with stats, you know, a little bit of time with you and they're good at, or they're doing both. I find it challenging to create and maintain. It's the maintain part, I think, that's hard for me. Maintaining a good role play of a character. In the last time we talked about D&D, I said that most of my characters just reflect some aspect about myself and some sort of wish fulfillment of wanting to be like the center of the story or the hero or whatever, right? But I find that a lot of my characters will start off more interesting than where they end up because I tend to drop a lot of the pretense of the role play, and then they just start speaking as I speak. But also I find it challenging to create interesting different characters in the sense of most of the time I'm just riffing on some sort of either stereotype or exaggeration, like all dwarves speak Scottish and
they're Scottish Vikings.
Yeah, they're Scottish Vikings, right? So I tend to default to not very creative options for characters.
To be fair, when I redesigned the D&D, or when I first designed the D&D setting we planned, there's a whole segment of dwarves that are Scottish Vikings, and it wasn't until I redesigned it like 6 years ago when I'm like, no, all dwarves are Scottish Vikings. That's dumb. My dwarves are evil and Greek.
But anyway, so those are kind of two of my challenges. One is sustaining the role play, and two, I find the creativity of coming up with something novel, or at least something that's not just stock tropes, I find challenging for myself.
Yeah, I remember being a new player and struggling a lot with the system. I joke about second edition and its Byzantine rules, but it's also that bit of when you have GMs who will say no, and sometimes saying no is important. It's not never say no, but often try and listen and say yes and. And even when you have to say no, understand, recognize that person's goals. And that was something I really struggled with under second edition. When I started out was not having clear goals, not knowing I needed clearer goals, and not knowing sort of how to make those goals clear to the GM. Because it isn't just the GM's responsibility to listen. Like, players can help make those goals clear, you know. And we'll do that sometimes. I'm sure we've done it in the past couple months where we'll have a scene that's sort of dirtling and we'll stop and we'll be like, what do you want? Like, what do we want to get out of this thing that's happening? Let's make sure we get that and then we'll move on.
I think that happened, like, even before with when we visited Mystic in our...
Totally. Mystic scenes are a whole separate thing, and we're not going to talk about them here. Yeah. But yeah, it's that idea where like, this is a scene that is entirely based on character desire and character development. Mm-hmm. So how do we reach this resolution? And understanding what resolution we're trying to get to then helps us play out that scene because we're all on the same page. And that was a thing that I found really challenging in when I started out was A, not knowing that, B, not knowing how to, like, not having the vocabulary to communicate that, and also the social pressure, like how you've talked a bunch about, you know, these are players who have already been playing for a year, they've got established characters, you know, everybody's level 5 and you're coming in sort of late, and there's that social pressure where they seem to have a bunch of stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
That happens sort of outside you, and trust me when I tell you we're gonna fix that. but more importantly, yeah, there's a bunch of social pressure that goes on with that, and it's sort of it is the responsibility, I think, of everyone at the gaming table to try and create space where like that social pressure is removed, where it is okay to stop a scene and go, you know, like or even and this is something that doesn't come up very often, but it's something I wish maybe I want to execute more, is to stop a scene and go, this isn't going the way that I wanted it to go. Mm. Like, here were my, like, because the better expectations we set.
Yeah, because then, because there are times where you spent a long time planning something and then we completely have derailed.
Oh, no. So let me be clear.
Oh, okay.
That's cool.
Okay.
That's you being agents and making choices. But in the sense of it's really easy to go into, for example, like a negotiation with a character, and if we don't set expectations sort of at the beginning of that, then it's easy to like get distracted or talk at cross purposes, and it winds up I like to use the term dirtling for like a scene that just goes nowhere. You know, I think everybody except for you maybe, Kyle, has sat through the hour-long shopkeeper thing where somebody's just like, I'm just going to just negotiate with a shopkeeper for an hour. We don't have those because after 2 minutes of negotiating, I'm like, okay, so what are we trying to get here? Like, are you trying to get deals? Are you trying to build a relationship with this character? Are you trying to, do you want to cultivate them as a contact? Like, what's, once we understand the outcome, it doesn't take us an hour to get there. We can do it in 10 minutes. And especially with seven players, it helps me sort of keep the action moving. Man, I suppose one question I have that isn't on our list is what does being a new player teach you? I mean, the answer I think is all kinds of things.
One thing is not be afraid of expressing your imagination. You know, at first I would hold back ideas because I would be like, oh no, that's stupid. But you come to learn that people don't think that way. Like people don't, you know, say, oh, that's dumb. Let's do it this way. You know, there will be times where people might help you along with your thoughts instead. And that's, I'm not saying your thoughts are wrong. It's just being like, hey, well, here's an idea. You know, they're helping out. That happened, in the last D&D where I was sort of, I had an idea, but I couldn't quite visualize it, and another player in our group helped me through it, and then I went along with it. And it was like, yeah, this is cool.
Yeah,
and then plot happened.
We all collectively make our ideas cooler.
Mm-hmm.
This is my favorite thing.
Yeah.
Like, how about you? What is something you learned from being a new player?
I would say something close to creative constraint. Learning to respect the rules and what's possible within the world.
Ooh, yeah. Because
one of the things that... The hardest thing for me to learn initially was that this is not a video game. And it doesn't follow video game logic. Case in point, really quick story. The first time I ever GM'd, my party almost died because I didn't understand how balancing the combat worked. And so I ended up having to Deus Ex Machina a woman coming in with a potion, like a pot of soup potion, and giving it to all the players so they didn't die in the middle of a combat.
Soup potion's so good, though. I'm stealing that.
Yeah, no, totally. Like, she basically just came in with a giant like pot of soup and like was able to give it to them, and that was essentially a healing potion. And so, yeah, you can become frustrated when you're trying to figure out how to do something. Like, oh, I should be able to hop over this. And it should be straightforward, but I have one character that's perpetually falling in the poop, and that is literally, like, what has happened to my character. I keep falling off of things I should not be falling off of, because the rules dictate that with my balance and then my crappy rolls, I am just perpetually falling. And we were doing a lot of sewer dungeon crawling and stuff.
Who's poop?
Yeah, we ran into an Odiug, and we found out, even the dungeon master did not realize that Odiugs have intelligence. And we ended up negotiating with an Odiug that was supposed
to be a villain. Link to the SRD entry for an Odiug down below.
Anyways, and so you have to learn to play within the rules. And it can be a challenging at first when you're coming from a video game background. But when you start to learn the rules and kind of respect them, then it forces you to be more creative in how you how you navigate the world.
One sort of interesting... it's not really a challenge, but I just find it maybe challenging for others is naming too. I tend to name my characters very Swedish names, and so people always have to ask me, "Well, how do you spell that name?"
Kyle, what's your D&D character's name?
Okay.
How do you spell that?
Okay.
That never gets old. Do not bump
knock
the bush
down the thing.
Oh, here's the hat.
It will crush you and kill you. And then you'll be gone, and I'll be sad, and everybody will be sad at D&D. Yeah, there's definitely the I am infamous for random words, like fantasy words, words I lifted from old languages, whatever, that like no one can pronounce. Like the whole the region that the D&D game is in is part of this enormous cursed landscape called the Mazian Kluktozi. And I'm like, so what? Those sounds don't exist in the English language. I don't care. I read it off an old Russian map. the naming is tricky.
I'm glad that's now recorded for posterity.
What?
That whatever you just said.
that.
I used to have a glossary, and I've considered rewriting one. For the new setting.
I think you need to add audio files to your wiki so that you can click on it to get the phonetic pronunciation.
Yeah, you can do that. It'd be funny. It'd be a lot of work.
Nazgul.
No, the thing I learned, and the thing that I'm still learning as a new player, and especially when I had to start GMing, is not just the importance of listening to players and to everyone else at the table, but also the importance of like how to listen and what to listen for. And it is easy to say listening is important. Mm-hmm. I mean, listening as a GM helps you understand what people are trying to get, and if I can understand their goals, I can help them achieve them, and we have fun. Like, I can put challenges in the way of those goals so that when they overcome those challenges, they know they're getting closer to their goals. Mm. And it creates a meaningful, like, progression. You know, I can have conversations about those goals, but sometimes it's hard to articulate what you want. Sometimes what you want changes something. Sometimes it's what you want out of a scene or a session. It depends on, like, who you are and how you play. And similarly, as a player, it is helpful for me to listen to other players. Like, I'm really bad for taking up too much decision-making space. Like, I love making the plan. I love being the guy with the idea. And that's really cool some of the time. But it's important to give other people space. You find the player... I was the player for a while where you want to stick it to the GM. You know, like, the GM has a plan. That's cool. Fuck your plan. We're going to the mountains. That way! And that can be really challenging and really annoying. And it is important to listen to the GM and find that frustration, because they are also playing this game. And it is a game that involves, like, give and take. So... I made a comment at a panel at Convergence, a D&D panel that I was on, about the importance of listening to cheaters and rules lawyers. And that I treat the two the same. And that was a thing that I did not know as a beginning player, where rules lawyers were, like, you know, immensely respected because they knew all the rules. And I didn't know all the rules. Rules lawyers are, if you're not familiar with the term, are people who know all the rules and use all the rules to their advantage,
mm-hmm.
and will happily spend more time nitpicking the rules than playing the game, to the constant consternation of other people around the table. And it is not even that they are wrong. It is just that arguing about it at the time is inconvenient. And cheaters are, of course, people who, you know, cheat. Fudge stats, fudge die rolls, whatever. You know. But at the end of the day, they are doing those things to try and accomplish something. They have something they want. And if I can listen for what that thing is, I can help them find other ways to get it. that work with everybody. And, you know, doesn't work all the time, but it has worked most of the time. So why keep doing it? Why come to D&D out of all the dorky, nerdy, stupid things you could do? Stupid fun things. Like, even if it is fun, lots of things are fun. Why come to D&D, start doing it, and then keep doing it for months, years, decades, fingers crossed for centuries? I'm going to run the coolest D&D game in my old folks' home, and we're going to run the same session every day. 100%. But yeah, why keep doing it? Let's start with Huck. Kyle, we'll get you to go last.
So let's see, in 15 years, well, I guess I should say I've been running the same...
Please don't say character. Actually, please do say character. Amazing.
No, it's the same world and storyline, but the characters, we've done three different iterations of characters. Nice. By advancing story. So, like, nobody's died. Well, none of my characters died. There's been a few characters that have died, but for the most part, we kind of end a natural progression and then just kind of jump forward 20 years or something with new characters.
That's rad.
You know, just because you want to make things fresh. So we've done that for the last 6 years with the campaign that I'm in. And I would say the thing that I keep doing it for, because, I mean, sometimes, you know, it takes 2 hours to advance the game 15 minutes. You know, like, it's just, it could be a slog, and especially in the last year with the lack of sleep that I had, sometimes I'd be falling asleep at the table in the lull parts. But I think, and I hate to use the buzzword, but, like, the co-creation of the story is what's most interesting. Mm-hmm. That by participating in the creation of the story, you become invested in it, and it's interesting. And especially when your character does have those shining moments where you happen to hit your good rolls, you know, you create those little mini legends out of the things, you leave a stamp, and then it becomes a series of in jokes with those friends.
Yep.
That bleed over into real life, I find. So that's, I think, why I keep doing it.
Nice.
The social co-creation aspect of it.
I always think of something that Mike Merles said. Mike Merles was lead designer on 4th edition. He writes Unearthed Arcana and does design work for 5th. And he said, D&D is the only game that gets more fun, like role-playing games in general, is the only games that get more fun the longer you play them. Any other pastime, any other media gets old. It gets boring. I mean, you can watch all the movies in the world, and you can see, like, even film critics now are getting sort of pissed off at all the remakes. You know, we're retreading old ground. In some ways, that's really cool. In some ways, you know, people are aggravated with it. You can play board games, but eventually you will master whatever board game you are playing, and you will move on to a different one. You know, the same is true of video games. The same is true, like, you're card games, sports, any kind of entertainment. You're either going to master it, or you're going to, not be able to do it anymore. In the case of, like, you know, professional sports, you know, blow out your knee or whatever. But D&D isn't like that. D&D, because of that co-creation that you mentioned, is always getting new. It's always refreshing. There's always new ideas that you can explore. And once you move outside of that into, like, other role-playing systems, you can do all kinds of things. You know, you can genre hack it to switch up the premises. And we ran a G.I. Joe game one night. It was so much fun. So yeah, like, there's worlds. I've done the advanced time thing too. Usually only 10 years, because I like seeing the kids in the campaign grow up. Mm-hmm. And so people who are in the know, when they encounter one of those kids as an adult, they're like, I had a hand in this person that now exists
as an NPC.
But they were always a non-player character, but they're like, I had a hand in shaping who this person is now. And, you know, in a sense, that's immortality. That's something that can never be taken away from you. You know, it's that idea that, your character's actions live forever. So, Kyle, you're new.
Yeah.
You like we're bringing this sort of like long live multi-campaign perspective of this is the high and mighty and noble reason why Dungeons and Dragons is particularly entertaining over the course of decades. I don't care where I'm from, and I don't care that my accent just changed. But as the newest player in this podcast, I would actually go with as the newest D&D player ever featured on this podcast, like if we count. If we discount people who have never, ever played. Mm-hmm. Why keep doing it? Like your game is on is 2 days from recording.
Yep. Well, I mean, you do get to build friendships with people. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, I'm getting to know some of the people in my campaign more and more, and it's nice that way. And there's, of course, you know, building your confidence in public speaking, I guess, in a sense.
Oh, totally mad.
and not being afraid to express your opinions and your thoughts, no matter how crazy they can be, because in D&D, of course, they can get super crazy. And just being creative and to have an outlet for creativity. Because you can bring all so many aspects of your own creative persona into D&D.
I'm so super excited. I'm also super excited for where Kyle's character is going.
Yeah.
Because I have some thoughts instead of saying. Tell us about your first D&D experience. Tell us about your games. If you have your games have web properties and whatnot, link them to us. Ours are in the show notes. Because we have a whole community, but I want to hear about your first D&D experiences, and I want to suckle at them like a vampire because it sounds amazing and awesome. But in the meantime, I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
I'm Kyle.
Stay awesome.
Stay awesome.
Nice. That went pretty well.
Oh, my butt hurts so much. I gotta stand up. Oh yes.